Hello friends, this video is a part of the series made in the memory of Dr. Shashi Sekhar. Entire collection is the result of a highly organized and efficient work done by him. All the surgeries shown here were performed by Dr. Shashi Sekhar himself. These videos are being uploaded now to help all budding laparoscopic surgeons in understanding various presentations of common surgical conditions and the techniques used to operate on them. This project is started in the hope to keep Dr. Shashi Sekhar alive in the memories of those who benefit from these videos. This is the laparoscopic hysterectomy series, and we are going to discuss about the second case in this series. The details of the patient are that she is a 41-year-old female with heavy irregular menstrual bleeding from the past 2 years. Pap smear showed dysplastic cells. Hence, laparoscopic hysterectomy was planned. A detailed description of the stepwise approach for laparoscopic hysterectomy is discussed in the video that follows. Inside the peritoneal cavity now, as you can see, there are a little bit of flimsy adhesions which are being separated using the harmonic scalpel. Probably because of prior tubectomy which the patient had long back. The last bit of adhesion is also separated now. In a hysterectomy, the advantage is that you can put a uterine manipulator or a colpotomizer which can change the direction of the uterus and facilitate the dissection of the adnexal structures. As you can see here, all the structures are labeled on the right side. So these are essentially the ones you need to remove to mobilize the uterus. These are the structures on the left side. The round ligament, the ovarian ligament, the fallopian tube, the ovary, and the posterior leaf of the broad ligament. So before going for the hysterectomy, inspecting the pouch of Douglas, that is the rectum, you see, and there is a minimal amount of serous fluid in the pouch of Douglas. The resection has started on the left side. Bipolar cautery is being used. Initially, the fallopian tube is cauterized. Now the ovarian ligament, and finally the round ligament. There is nothing as the order in which you have to do the things. It's your comfort. You can come from above downwards or below upwards, or you can start in the middle as it is being done now. So initially it's cauterized, and now a harmonic is being used. You can use a lot of other devices also. You can directly do it with a harmonic. You can use a ligature. You can use an end seal. It doesn't matter much. Depends upon your preference. All you need is effective hemostasis. That is the only thing. Even after taking so much of care, there is every chance that there might be a tiny culprit vessel which will bleed, or there might be a back bleed from the uterine side. So all you need to do is apply a little bit of pressure and some more cautery. This is not the bubble to be afraid about, but you need to be careful that you are not injuring the sigmoid colon or the rectum, which is just beneath these structures. And you should not go far down also without dissecting the layers separately. So now you can start to make out the anterior and posterior layers or leaves of the broad ligament. Now anterior is slightly dissected, and now we have come to the right side. So on right side, first the ovarian ligament is being cauterized. As I told you, there is no specific order. You can do it either way. And now the fallopian tube, and finally the round ligament. now this will be cut using the harmonic scalpel. Cut and coagulate at the same time, which will minimize the chances of bleeding. Using a harmonic scalpel takes some time. You need to be careful, you need to be patient. But surprisingly, you'll be able to save a lot of time actually. So again, a bipolar is being used. As you can see, despite taking so many measures, a little bit of ooze was there, but luckily it got controlled for now. And this is the part where you can confidently use the energy source as much as you want, because you know that you are nowhere near the uterine artery or the ureter, which are the important structures you need to be careful about while dissecting. So now you can clearly make out the anterior and the posterior leaves of the broad ligament. There is a bleed from the uterine side, probably a back bleed. You'll need some amount of cauterizing. So it's almost done. Now again the field is clear. Now coming back to the left side, the anterior leaf of the broad ligament is being dissected out. You need to just pull it anteriorly and then start dissecting. This will greatly reduce the chances of injury to the urinary bladder. The yellow circle which I have shown there roughly represents the area of the bladder. Because it is an extraperitoneal structure, all you need to do is, once you have opened up the anterior leaf of the broad ligament, that is the peritoneal covering over it, a gentle dissection will push the bladder away from the cervical region of the uterus, so that finally when you are doing a circular cut to separate the uterus from the vagina, you will be able to avoid injury to the bladder. So all this is the connective tissue which is almost devoid of blood vessels, so you need not worry much about the bleeding risk here. All you need to take care is about not injuring the bladder. If you go in the correct anatomical plane, you need not worry about looking for the ureter or thinking that you might have injured the ureter. No need to worry about that, as long as you have followed the correct plane. So a little bit of soft tissue connections between the uterus and the bladder are being separated. So the bladder is almost free from the uterine attachment here, and it's at a relatively safer distance. We can even dissect it further if needed. Little bit of energy source to stop any minor bleed there. Now coming to the dissection of the posterior layer of the broad ligament. This is also this also follows the same rule as we did on the anterior side. The structures vary. Anteriorly you need to take care about the urinary bladder. Posteriorly you need to take care about the ureter as well as the uterine arterial bulb, which should not get injured and should not cause any spotting. See, here there is some amount of ooze, so it's being cauterized again. Now the dissection is continued. separating the posterior leaf of the broad ligament. All you need to do is gently push the soft tissue towards the uterus and pull the peritoneum away from the uterus, such that you can be sure that you are not injuring any structures. So coming to the right side, again the posterior layer dissection has started. In this video, I'm not able to show you the ureter actually, because sir didn't go into the specific region of the ureter searching for it. But as such, you can see you don't encounter any tubular structure with peristalsis, because we are at a pretty safe distance from it. This is the uterosacral mechanrod ligament complex area. You need to preserve part of it. You should not remove entirety, because when you finally remove the uterus and are closing the vaginal vault, taking a bite or two to this ligamental complex will prevent vault prolapse. The area where the uterine bulb or the uterine artery will be there. So cauterizing it, actually applying harmonic for some amount of time, so that it gets coagulated properly. Again, to be extra sure, a bipolar is also applied. Basically, the using an energy source is a surgeon's preference. It depends upon your exposure and expertise. But definitely, these will save a lot of time instead of manual dissection and tying knots. A surgical oncologist might apply clips that will help him localize the region further for follow-up and radiotherapy. But here, the indication was not a malignancy. It was dysmenorrhea and heavy menstrual bleeding. So we need not worry about that. As you can see here, this is the area where the uterine artery just turns up and continues along the lateral border of the uterus, and this is the area where we will be separating the uterus from the vagina. So you need to ensure that there is adequate hemostasis. Same thing repeated on the right side as well, using a bipolar to coagulate the area of the uterine artery. You need not worry about the ureter, because you have dissected out the anterior and the posterior layers of the broad ligament. So ureter won't be anywhere near this artery now. It's almost done. We are using the harmonic now to cut it a bit. Now we are completing the posterior dissection. As you can see, the Mackenrod uterosacral ligament complex is labeled there. We are trying to retain a part of it so that the vaginal vault can be sutured later. So the bladder is already at a safer distance, but if you want to be sure, you can just dissect it out further. What is being held with on the right side is the bladder, and on the left side a harmonic is used. Presently it is being used for blunt dissection. You can clearly make out the bladder there. There is a little amount of bleed, it doesn't matter much. So now the bladder is relatively far. Now, to be doubly sure, sir is applying the bipolar for the final time all around the area where we are going to cut it. So, left side is almost secured now with good amount of hemostasis. This is the area you need to be a bit careful, but as such, as I told you, because the posterior layer has been dissected properly, there is very minimal chance of the ureter getting injured. So same process is repeated on the right side. Little more coagulation of the uterine bulb area and little bit separation of the bladder, and finally separating the uterus from the vaginal vault. Here a hook is being used. You can use a harmonic, you can use a spatula, you can use any type of energy source you are comfortable with. The dissection or the separation is continued posteriorly, and as you can see, the field is almost bloodless. This is the part which we are going to retain, this small part posteriorly, so that we can put a suture. Now dissection is proceeded anteriorly towards the right side. Vision might be obscured a bit because of the smoke. Now it's almost done, only the right side posterior aspect is remaining. This surgery typically takes around 45 minutes to 1 hour. We can do it faster with more experience, but there is no benefit in hurrying. So you can clearly make out the cervix now, and that is the event manipulator or call optimizer through which we'll be pulling out the address. Now the address is out and suture material is put in through the same route, because that is a wider lumen area, can easily bring in the suture material. Now the first bite is taken over the anterior part of the vagina and then continue towards the posterior. See, the holding technique for the needle also matters. Now as you can see here, a bite is taken into the ligament also. As I have told previously, this will prevent the wall prolapse. There is no need to entirely close the peritoneum as such. So the knot is being put and tightened. It might look like a bit clumsy closure, but this will do the job, because all you need to do is approximate the anterior and the posterior vaginal wall together along with the supporting structures so that it is leak proof and no bowel content gets displaced into the vagina. See, the holding technique for the needle requires some amount of decent training, otherwise it's pretty difficult, and you would wish you would close it in any other route, transvaginal route, or like open it and close it off, because this will definitely be a lot of struggle if you are not practicing enough. So this will be the final knot, and the procedure is almost done. It's tight and secure, so a little wash in the pelvic cavity and suctioning will ensure that we have secured a good hemostasis, and there it is. You can clearly make out the bladder anteriorly, the rectum posteriorly. Unfortunately, I couldn't show you the actual peristaltic movements of the ureter in this video. We'll try to do so in upcoming ones. A drain is placed now. It's not mandatory, it's your own preference though. and the surgery essentially ends here.
Thanks for watching. Credit for this idea goes to Dr. Preeti, beloved wife of Dr. Shashi Sekhar, and this is Dr. Anirudh giving the voiceover. If you like it, please do click the like button and share. To continue watching more such videos, please do subscribe to our channel and click the bell icon for notifications.